Gift yourselves new opportunity.
अरे मैडम क्या कह रही
हैं
आप? आइए आइए
बुलंद बुलंद सर्विस स्टार्ट मत. योर वॉइस इज नॉट देयर. हेलो मैम, यू प्लीज अनप्लग योर माइक्रोफोन. आई गेस देयर इज सम साउंड. Unmute your mic. Ma'am, unmute. We are extremely sorry for a delay in starting of the third day of our FDP. We'll be shortly starting the session. There is some technical issue. We'll solve that technical issue very shortly and we'll come back. Thank you. Hello.
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now it is okay, ma'am. Hello.
Yeah.
I think now that's okay. So shall we start?
Finally.
Yes.
Okay, so good afternoon all participants. I welcome to the third day of EFDP organized by IQSE cell of UCA Tersaria University. Welcome all participants on a third day. So we have a special guest with us today, Dr. Mrudula Bele ma'am. She is a pharmacist by training with a PhD in pharmaceutical science, having strong interest in intellectual property rights and regulatory affairs of pharmaceuticals. Additionally, she is possessing a postgraduate diploma in patents law from Nalsar University of Law, LLB from Pune University, and LLM from University of Turin, Italy. She has attended under full fellowship from World Intellectual Property Organization, popularly known as WIPO, a one-year Masters of Law, that is LLM, intellectual property course jointly conducted by WIPO and University of Turin, Italy. The fellowship is given every year to 11 teachers of intellectual property law. She was the only Indian to get the fellowship in the year of 2012 and 13. The course was fully funded by WIPO, amounting to around 30,000 euros. She has attended a 15-day training in Tokyo twice on Japanese patent law. The training was fully funded by Japanese Patent Office and WIPO. She is currently working as an associate professor at NDMPP College Pharmacy, Nasik. Along with teaching core pharmaceutical science subjects, involved in teaching subjects such as intellectual property law, research methodology, and drug regulatory affairs to the undergraduate and postgraduate students. She has authored 3 books, several research papers in several national and international journals. Additionally, she engaged in consultation assignments for the pharmaceutical industry in the area of conventional and novel pharmaceutical and cosmetic formulations. She is working as a freelance patent consultant for clients in India and abroad in the domain of chemicals and pharmaceuticals. She has authored a column in reputed newspaper Lok Satta on various aspects of intellectual property law. The column was in simple storytelling way, which could be easily comprehended by novice. The compilation of the writing have been published as a book by the same name. The book has received following awards so far: Milind Sonogram Smriti Award for the best book published in the year 2017 on the topic related to economics; Marathi Literature Society's Award for the book published in year 2017 on a topic related to economics; Maharashtra State Government's Award for the best book published in year 2017 on a topic related to economics. So it's indeed a great pleasure and privilege for all of us to have Dr. Mrudula Bele Madam. She is going to talk on a topic of patents, a key to journey from invention to innovation. So rather than wasting much of your time, I would request Mrudula Madam to start away with the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Krunal. I am very much thankful to UCAT, Sadia University and Maliba College for giving me this opportunity to reach out to so many professors all across India. So I am very sorry for the technical glitches from my side. Without wasting any more time, we should straight away, I feel, start with my lecture. All right, so the topic theme is patents, a key to journey from invention to innovation. Generally, we use these two words, invention and innovation, synonymously, but as we proceed with my lecture, we would be able to understand what is the difference between invention and innovation. So if you don't see a problem with this question, you need this class. I work as a patent consultant, and many times people come to me and they ask us questions. All I asked was, can I patent my copyrighted trademark? And if many of you also have such questions, then you definitely need this class, because there is a difference between patent and copyright and trademarks, because these are different forms of intellectual property. So intellectual property, as the name suggests, is basically creation of the mind or intellect. And intellectual property rights are the legal rights governing the use of creations of the human minds. Just like other forms of property like land and gold and money, this property, intellectual creations, can also be treated as property because you can make money using this property. And therefore, it is also called property. There are some features of intellectual property. It is intangible. You cannot count or measure the creations of mind like you can measure gold or land. It is non-rivalrous, because what do we mean by this? That even if somebody steals our intellectual property, we still have it. So we can enjoy the property as well as the person who is stealing it can enjoy. And that is the meaning of non-rivalrous. So there is a difference between the other forms of property like money and land and gold. They can be measured. Intellectual property cannot be measured. The other forms of properties are rivalrous. If somebody steals it from you, you don't have it anymore. But intellectual property, even if someone steals it, you still have it. So that is what we mean by non-rivalrous. And you cannot put fences around your ideas. If you want to protect your land, you can put a fence around it. If you want to protect your money, you can put it in the bank. But how can you put fences around your ideas? You cannot. And therefore, it is non-excludable. That is another difference. We straightway come to patent law without wasting our time on other forms of intellectual property. So just like copyrights and trademarks and industrial designs and geographical indicators, another form of intellectual property is patents. And patents are obtained on technological inventions. It can be a product or a process. We'll see that later. So what is the need to have a patent? There is something in economics of patent law, which is called as Arrow's information paradox. So what do we mean by that? So what happens is an inventor often, suppose I'm an academic inventor and I have some made some invention in my lab, but I am it works very well, but I am not in a position to start a factory and start manufacturing it on an industrial level. So what I obviously want is to hand over that technical know-how to someone, and I expect money in return, obviously. So in that case, what happens is I would like to get in touch with some industrial industry person. Now, if the person has to decide whether to buy that invention from me or not to buy, I have to disclose it. I have to disclose my invention fully. But once I disclose it, and then if the person says that he doesn't want to buy it from me, and then later if he starts copying it, I cannot do anything. On the other hand, so because of which an inventor is always scared to share the information about his technical knowledge. But at the same time, if I do not disclose it to the industrial person, then he would not buy it. So I'm always caught in a dilemma, and that is what is called as information paradox, that whether I want to disclose my invention or I don't want to disclose my invention. So the inventor is scared. If he doesn't disclose it, then nobody will take it from him. If he discloses it, then there is a fear of losing the information. And this is called as the information paradox. And that is the reason we need to have something called as patent. So if an academic inventor like me has filed a patent and then I disclose it to somebody and the person doesn't want to buy it, it's okay because I have a patent on that. So that is the reason having a patent is extremely important for any inventor. Now, I said in the title of my talk that it is a key to the journey of the invention from invention to innovation. So when I make something on a lab scale, it is called as invention. And when someone starts manufacturing it on the industrial scale, then it is called as innovation. So if you want your invention to travel from invention to innovation, it is very essential that you have a patent in place. Otherwise, you always suffer from this information paradox, and you will find several scientists whose inventions die because they do not take patents. So why there is a need to have a patent then for an invention? That it is an incentive to invent. You have spent your money, you have spent your intellect on inventing it. So you need to get something in return, and what you get is the monopoly. So that is an incentive to invent further. It is an incentive to disclose. You want to disclose the information.
Hello, ma'am, your voice is not there. Hello. Hello. I think again there is some technical issues. Participants, please hold on. We are trying to solve the technical issues. We will shortly resume. By this time, participants, just for the time being, just reminding you all participants, for today's session, both the sessions, you have to fill up your attendance, your feedback and quiz by 12 o'clock tomorrow. So before 12 noon, you have to submit your attendance, your feedback, and you also have to attempt the quiz. It has also came to our notice that your registration numbers, I mean, participants are making mistake in entering registration number. So please fill that registration number correctly. I think madam is back. Ma'am, now, is it okay? I mean,
yes.
Yeah, you can start now.
Yeah, so we were talking about patents, and patent is, I was saying that patent is a negative right. It is a right to exclude others from using your invention. It may not be a positive right. Sometimes the patent owner himself may not be able to exercise his own right, but he always can stop others from using his right. What is an invention? What is patentable? So if you are inventing something in a if we are inventing something in our lab, then how do we decide whether it is a patentable invention? For the purpose of patent law, an invention means it should be a new product or a process to make a product, and it has to be new, it has to have an inventive step, and it should be capable of industrial application. We'll see one by one what do we mean by that. So it must relate to a process or a product or a both. It cannot be a method of marketing, or it cannot be anything other than a process or a product. It cannot be a method to play a game and so on. It has to be new, that is, it has to be novel. It has to involve an inventive step, which means it should not be obvious. It should be capable of industrial application, and it should not fall under the non-patentable subject matter. So whatever you have invented, if it falls under all these, if it satisfies all these criteria, then it can be considered to be patentable, otherwise not. So what, when do we say that the invention is novel? When it has not been published in any written publication anywhere in the world. So written publication means it should not be disclosed in any research article or any patent or any news article or anywhere. It should not be disclosed by written publication. It should not be disclosed orally. You must not have spoken about it in any conference before the date of filing a patent. It is not being sold anywhere in the market. It is not being offered for sale. What do we understand by offering for sale? Offering for sale means exhibiting in an exhibition. So you should not display your invention in an exhibition before filing a patent on that. And it should not be otherwise known to the public anywhere in the world. So the last part, anywhere in the world, applies to all these five things. It should not be published in written publication anywhere in the world, should not be disclosed anywhere in the world, should not be sold anywhere in the world, should not be offered for sale anywhere in the world, and otherwise known to the public. What do we mean by that? So there are some things which have not been written, we don't talk about it, not being sold for that, but people know it otherwise, because it is a traditional knowledge. And the example is a very famous example is turmeric. So we use turmeric as an antiseptic on a wound because we have seen our parents doing that. I do it because I have seen my mother doing it. My mother does it because she has seen her mother doing it. So we know that haldi is an antiseptic as a traditional knowledge in India. That is what is called as otherwise known to the public. So your invention should not be a traditional knowledge of some community anywhere in the world. If it is, then it is not patentable. What do we mean by inventive step? The other name for inventive step is non-obviousness. So a feature of the invention is it should not be obvious. I can give you a simple example that there is a chemical compound which can be used as a drug, suppose, and the molecule, I end up synthesizing the molecule in my lab, and then later I realize that it has been patented already. So I make a small change in my I make a small change in that chemical structure. So for example, there was a methyl group which I replaced by ethyl group, and I know it is still going to work as that drug. So when I replace a methyl group by an ethyl group, I still maintain the novelty of my invention, because when it was the same molecule which has been patented, then it would have lagged the first step itself, that is, it was not novel. So in order to introduce novelty in my substance, what I do is I replace methyl group with an ethyl group. So is it novel now? Yes, because it has not been published anywhere. But then replacing methyl with ethyl is very obvious to a person trained in the field of art. So for a medicinal chemist, it is very obvious to replace methyl with ethyl because we know that both the groups have a similar function. So in that case, my invention is said to be obvious over the state of the art, or it is said to miss the inventive step from changing the methyl group to ethyl group. The step is not inventive at all, and therefore we call it we say that the invention does not have an inventive step, or it is not non-obvious. So your invention has to be novel, it has to be non-obvious, or the other name for non-obviousness is inventive step. The third step which it must fulfill is called industrial application. So can you make the invention on an industrial scale? I'll give you an example. You know the Newton's third law of motion, or you know the Einstein's theory of relativity, E is equal to mc squared. So Newton's third law of motion, is it a product or a process to make a product? No. So it cannot be manufactured industrially. It does not have any industrial application. Howsoever great that work is, it is a discovery and not an invention. It always existed in nature. Newton did not invent it. He did not make it. So such kind of basic researches are considered non-patentable because they do not have an industrial application. They are discoveries and they are not inventions. And patents are given only on applied researches. So when you have done some research in your lab and you want to decide whether your invention is patentable or not, what all things you need to cross-check, whether it is a process or a product to make a process, whether it is novel, does it have an inventive step or is it non-obvious? Does it have industrial application? If yes, then your invention may be patentable. But there is one more criteria. It should not fall under the non-patentable subject matter. What does this mean? So even if your invention is a product or a process, it is novel, it has an inventive step, it has an industrial application, but there in each country's patent law, there are some inventions which are considered to be non-patentable in that country. So even if it satisfies all the criteria of patentability, it would not obtain a patent because the country's patent law has listed that patents would not be given on such type of inventions in that country. So patents are always a territorial right. Something which is patentable in India may not be patentable in the United States of America and vice versa. So what are the generally considered non-patentable subject matters? A living organism cannot get a patent, okay? Because a living organism is nature's, it is made by nature. It is not a man-made thing. So life forms generally do not get a patent. Softwares do not get a patent because softwares are written in algorithm 0101. It is a code. So it is not a product or a process to make a product. So softwares as such are not patentable. But if it is a software which is a part of a hardware, then it may be patentable. And business methods are not patentable. For example, you might have heard about Amway or Tupperware, the multi-level marketing business, which is a method of doing business. It is neither a product nor a process to make a product. So the business methods are not patentable. And though every country has a different patent law, these things are generally considered non-patentable everywhere in the world. But apart from that, but there are some exceptions. So for example, this is called as the Diamond versus Chakravarti case. Chakravarti was a scientist who created this microorganism, Pseudomonas putida. So it was not, he carried out certain genetic manipulations in the microorganism so that he created a new microorganism which was capable of breaking crude oil. It could eat oil. And so the oil, this microorganism can be used to treat the oil spills in the ocean. So in the first, when Chakravarti applied for a patent in the United States of America, because it is a living organism, the patent was denied. But why patents are not given on living organisms? That is because they cannot be made by man. And remember, the patent laws were made in the 18th century when people did not know that at one point of time, man would be able to make life forms in the labs. That was not known. So, but Anand Mohan Chakravarti claimed that this is not a naturally occurring microorganism, and he has manufactured it in his lab. So though it is a living form, it is a man-made living form, and it should be getting a patent. So his plea was accepted in the United States of America because and they started applying this this concept of non-patentability of life forms in a different way after this. The court started saying that if it is a life form which is naturally occurring in the nature, then it would not get a patent because you have just discovered it. You have not invented. But Chakravarti's microorganism was invented by him. He had manufactured it in the lab, so it got the patent. Since then, the microorganisms became patentable, but the large organisms were still not patentable. Then came this case of Harvard Oncomouse, where the scientist in the Harvard University, again, the scientist manufactured this new mouse, which they were going to use as an animal model to do cancer research. So they had genetically manipulated. This was a transgenic animal. They had introduced an oncogene that can trigger the growth of cancer in that animal so that it can be used as a guinea pig to study the oncology medicines. So they applied for a patent on this oncomouse. It was denied again, saying patents cannot be given on large organisms. But again, they pleaded the same, that it is an animal which has been made by us, manufactured by us. So it is an invention, should get a patent. But as I said, that the patent laws are different for every country. So this Harvard Oncomouse did not get a patent in Canada. It did get a patent in the United States, and it also got the patent in European Patent Office, but it did not get a patent in Canada, because every country applies the patent law differently. And then this was a third case where the Myriad Genetics, they had isolated a gene which is called BRCA1 and 2 genes, which they were trying to use this, they had hypothesized that if there is a mutation on this BRCA1 and 2 genes, then the likelihood of breast cancer in the female is very high. So this can be used to test breast cancer. So they developed certain diagnostic tests and they tried to file a patent on this gene, saying, and then the question was whether a patent can be given on a DNA, because DNA is not man-made. So their argument was, we have isolated this. And then the court denied this, saying, though you have isolated a DNA, you have not created it. So giving a patent on an isolated DNA is like giving a patent on a branch of tree. So because the tree is not patentable, you have cut a branch of the tree and you are trying to apply a patent for that. So patents are not given on isolation of DNA. So this is something about the this was something about the patentability of life form. Another thing is patents on there is a question of morality. So even if the invention is patentable, it fits in all, it satisfies all the criteria. If it is immoral in nature, this was a very famous case that Oliver Bruceley had filed a patent on obtaining nerve cells from the human embryonic stem cells. So he had used human embryonic stem cells to obtain nerve cells, and he filed a patent on that. So it fulfilled all the criteria of patentability. But the there was a case filed on Oliver Bruceley by an organization called Greenpeace, and they said that it should not be given a patent because he has killed a human embryo for making these cells, which is something that is immoral. So even if the patent is have all the criteria of patentability, but if the courts feel or if the patent office feels that it is immoral or it is going to disturb the order of the public, then it may not get a patent. I can give you a simple example in India that if you come up with a diagnostic test which can very easily diagnose whether the embryo or whether the baby in the womb is a female child or whether it is a fetus of a male or it is a fetus of a female. So it is a great invention. It is novel. It does have inventive step. It does has industrial application. But if a patent is given on this and it comes in the market, then it would be very immoral for the Indian society, because people will start there would be female feticides in a large number. So such type of patents are not given if the patent office feels that it is immoral or it is against the public order. Then this is an example of geographical, traditional knowledge. All of you have heard about the turmeric patent case, right? So turmeric was given a patent on its antiseptic use in the United States of America. Then India filed tried to revoke this case, saying it is our traditional knowledge and you cannot file a patent on our traditional knowledge. We saw that if it is otherwise known to the public, then one cannot file a patent on that. So we had to prove that turmeric is our traditional knowledge. So for that, CSIR had to find out several old references from our Ayurveda texts. And these texts were not in English. So obviously, the patent office was, American patent office was not in a position to read it. So we had to prove it in the courts that it is our traditional knowledge. And then the patent was revoked. Same is the case with a neem patent, or there are several others. So this is called as biopiracy. When a country tries to patent the traditional knowledge of some other country, it is called as biopiracy. India has done a wonderful initiative which is called as Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. We'll not go into the details of this, but India has tried to create a database of the traditional formulations which are available in the Indian traditional medicine, be it Ayurveda or Yunani or Siddha, so that if a patent is filed on a herbal medicine anywhere in the world, then the patent offices of that country can search through the TKDL of India, and then they will not give a patent. Because what happened in case of neem or haldi was the patent was granted, and then we had to file a suit in the courts in the America, which was a very expensive thing for us. So we thought that rather than fighting out after the patent is granted, we should do something so that we can stop the grant of such patents. And for that, India has created this traditional knowledge digital library, TKDL. Please go to the website of TKDL and find, and you will find amazing things about this. And this was India's attempt to document and protect its own traditional knowledge. No other country has done similar. We were the pioneers in, we have shown the rest of the world how a country should protect its own traditional knowledge. So after this TKDL was established, India has been able to stop the grant of almost 1,000 patents. So they were not granted because they were based on India's traditional knowledge. Then we'll quickly go through what all is not patentable in India, non-patentable subject matter. Somehow I have mixed out. This is called as Section 3 exclusions. So Section 3 in the Indian Patent Act enlists all the things which are not patentable in India, though they fulfill the criteria of novelty, non-obviousness, and industrial application. So you have to check through this list whether your invention falls under Section 3 exclusions. And if yes, then it would not be given a patent in India. So Section 3A, which I have missed out, is it is something which is against the laws of nature. So if you're trying to file a patent on something which is against the law of nature, example is you are trying to claim a machine in which the output is more than input. So you obviously know that this is not possible. This is against the scientific principles, so it will not get a patent. Section 3B is if, as we discussed before, if it is commercial exploitation of that invention, if it is going to be contrary to the public order, or if it is going to be contrary to the morality, then it will not get a patent. Then Section 3C, if you have merely discovered a scientific principle, I told you that if it is Einstein's theory of relativity is a basic scientific principle from physics, but it does not have any applied importance, so it will not get a patent. You have just formulated an abstract theory. If it is a living thing which is naturally occurring, it is a non-living substance occurring in the nature. So suppose you have discovered a new iron ore. So you have not manufactured it. You have not invented it. It was always there in the nature. You have just discovered it. So these things would not get a patent under Section 3C of the Indian Patent Act. Then Section 3D, if you have merely discovered a new form of a known substance, this is particularly for pharmaceuticals. So if you are trying to file a patent on a drug, which is just a new form of a known substance. So for example, it is a salt of already patented drug, or it is a isomer, or it is an enantiomer. If it is a ester, ether, polymorph. So already, for example, there is cetirizine and there is levocetirizine. So levocetirizine is a enantiomer of, it is a resolved isomer. They have resolved the enantiomers of cetirizine and they are trying to market one. So if it is a new form of already known substance, levocetirizine is a new form of cetirizine. So if it does not show enhancement in the known efficacy, if you cannot prove that it has a better therapeutic efficacy than cetirizine, then it will not get a patent in India. We are talking about India here. So this is Section 3D, which is very, very important for pharmaceuticals. Section 3E, if it is a mere admixture of two things, there is something called thing A and there is B. So you have just mixed A with B, but there is no advantage in mixing A with B. Even in combination, A will act as A and B will act as B, then it will not get a mixture. There is no synergistic effect upon adding A to B. Section 3F, You have merely arranged or rearranged or duplication of known devices, each functioning independently. So suppose you have fitted a torch to a bucket, where the bucket is still a bucket and a torch is still a torch. So you cannot file a patent on this arrangement, which is merely a rearrangement of two known devices which can function independent of each other. There is an umbrella fitted with a fan. So fan is still a fan, an umbrella is still an umbrella. This will not get a patent in India. Section 3H, if you have found out a new method of agriculture or horticulture, like there is a cultivation method of cultivating an algar or producing new form of a known plant, it does not get a patent in India because India is a agriculture country. And remember, when we give a patent to someone on something, then we create a monopoly, and because of which things become expensive. Section 3I, any process of medicinal, surgical, creative, prophylactic, diagnostic, therapeutic treatments of human beings. So a new method of surgery or a new diagnostic method cannot get a patent in India because, again, India's aim is to reduce the cost of healthcare. 3J, plants and animal in whole or any part thereof, other than microorganisms, are not patentable if they are naturally occurring. So naturally occurring plants and animals, just because you have discovered a new variety of some plant, which was always existing, you just have discovered it, then it is not patentable. Mathematical methods or business methods or algorithms or computer programs per se are not patentable. But as I said, if you show the software or computer program to be a part of a hardware, then it can get a patent. Section 3I, a literary dramatic, if it is a novel or a drama or a music, it doesn't get a patent because it is protected under copyright. Section 3M, a mere scheme or rule or method of performing mental act or method of playing game. So suppose there are different methods of playing chess. So some player uses a very typical method which he has invented, but it is not a product or not a process to make a product. These kind of things cannot be patented. Or you might have heard about Vedic maths or abacus. It is a method of performing a mental act, does not get a patent. Section 3N, presentation of information. So you merely, example is dictionary. So you just have presented an information, or here on this PowerPoint presentation, I'm just presenting an information which is already existing in public domain. So I can't get a patent on such things. Section 3O, integrated circuits, the topography of integrated circuits do not get a patent because it is protected in India under a different intellectual property, right? Inventions which are a traditional knowledge. We talked a lot about this. What is a traditional knowledge? So if you try to find out or try, you have made a formulation, Ayurvedic formulation containing haldi, which has an antiseptic activity, and you try to file a patent on that formulation for the antiseptic activity, it will not get a patent in India. And section 4, in which anything which is related to atomic energy cannot be patented in India because only the government can own the rights on these things. So all the things which are listed in section 3, from section 3A to section 3O, and according to section 4, anything which is related to atomic energy. So all the Department of Atomic Energy organizations like BARC and all, they come up with several inventions, but they can't file a patent on that because all those inventions are related to atomic energy. So I feel because of the shortage of time, I'll stop here. And I tried to give you a brief idea about how can you decide whether the invention you have created is patentable or not, and how getting a patent on your invention is a key to journey of your invention from invention to innovation. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, madam. It is really indeed an informative session. So shall we take few questions from the participants?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I can see there are many questions, but some of you, you might have already covered during your presentation. One is, can we publish the data after patent get published? I think you have mentioned about the journey.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, so if you say something.
But the journal, if you want to publish a paper, then the date of publication of the paper should not be before the date of filing the patent.
Right.
Or even if you have come up with an invention during your PhD research, so you should file a patent before submitting your thesis.
True. There is another question. What is the simple procedure for admitting a patent? And simple procedure for submitting a patent.
Yeah, it's not a simple procedure, but you have to, for the most important thing in submitting a patent is drafting a patent. And while drafting a patent, you have to draft the claims. So first you have to draft a patent and you have to fully disclose what you have done. Then there are four patent offices in India, and depending upon your jurisdictions, like Gujarat and Maharashtra comes under Mumbai Patent Office. There are four forms which you have to file, you have to fill, in which you have to completely describe the invention. You have to file the four forms at the patent office. You have to apply for a request for examination. After the examination request is submitted, the patent office will examine your patents. Then it will be published in a journal. After publication, anybody would be able to take an objection to that invention. If nobody takes an invention, the patent would be examined. You will receive a examination report from the patent office in which they might have asked for some questions. They might have raised some queries. You have to answer those queries. And if they are satisfied with your queries, then the patent would be granted. This takes almost 2.5 to 3 years. But I would like to inform you that the life of the patent starts from the date on which you have filed it and not from the date on which it has been granted. So if I have filed a patent today and it has been granted after 3 years, but the life of patent, all of us know, is 20 years. So it starts from today and not from 3 years later.
Yeah, there is another question. Can we consider clinical trials occurs in new drugs as a patent or not? I mean, can we file this new trials that we are doing on drugs? No. Again, you have to apply the same logic.
Is it a product or a process to make a product? No. But not in India, but in America and European countries, these clinical trial data are protected by another thing which is called as data exclusivity. So the clinical trial data cannot be shared. You can protect it. Nobody can use it for 3 years or 5 years and so on. But not in India. You do not have a data exclusivity in India.
And I think there is another last question. If seeds are modified in the lab to have more production, more crop productions, can we file a patent of that kind of aspects?
No. Because it is a method of agriculture. Not in India, but in other countries, yes.
You have mentioned in your presentation that it is specific to particular country. I mean, you have to check about the laws in particular countries. Yeah.
Yes.
So
I can see a few questions asked by Professor Ranch. I'll shortly answer them. He is asking me that whether there can be an international patent. So no, patent is a territorial right, and there cannot be a global patent which you file and your invention is protected in the entire world. No. So if you want to protect you want to sell your product in 12 countries, you have to get a patent in 12 different countries. And there is no global patent because thing which is patentable in country A may not be patentable in country B. So it is always a territorial right. There does not exist something called as a global patent. And yes, if there is a new medicine becoming available for corona, then it would be patentable, obviously. But if it is a old medicine, we hear a lot about drug repurposing today for corona. So if it is a repurposed drug, then you cannot get a patent on the second medical use of the drug in India. But otherwise, in other countries, you do get a patent, even on the new use of an already existing medicine. Yeah.
So I think that's all about all the questions. So at last, I am really very much thankful to you for spending your valuable time and deliver
Thank
a
you.
Session.
Thank you.
You have rightly mentioned if one wants to travel from invention to innovation, one should file a patent. And that is how, you know, that is how the persons can remove from the information paradox. So thank you very much, madam. On behalf of Ukata Saya University, I am really very thankful to you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so once again, good afternoon, everybody. We would be starting with our second session of the day. We have with us Dr. Bankim Patel, sir. I welcome you, sir. So let me introduce the speaker of the second session today. Dr. Bankim Patel, sir, is currently working as a professor and director of computer science MCA program in Srimad Rajchandra Institute of Management and Computer Application, Ukata Sarya University, Badoli. His career began at VNSU Surat in 1988 and has a wide experience of 31 years in research and teaching in the area of computer science and applications. He has worked and is working in many bodies and committees of different universities, as well as that of government in different capacities. To name few of them includes Board of Studies, Faculty, Board of Management, Senate, NBA, UGC, Selection Committee, Research Committee, Examination Reformations, etc. He has worked as a Control of Examination as well. Currently, he is holding a position of Dean of Faculty of Computer Science at Ukata Sarya University. He has earned his PhD from VNSU in 1996. Prior to it, PGDCA in 1988 and graduation as well as post-graduation in the year of 1985 and 1987, respectively, from Sardar Patel University, Vallabh Vidyanagar. Currently, his area of research includes natural language processing and intelligent systems. Under his able guidance, 14 candidates have received PhD degree, while two are MPhil holders in computer science and applications. Presently, he is guiding 4 PhD research scholars. He has authored 75 plus papers in international and national reputed journals, 2 articles and 4 books so far. He has been invited as a session chair and expert in events ranging from institute level meet to international conferences. He has been honored with several awards. To name a few of them are by Gujarat Innovation Society for work related to visually impaired person, Best Research Paper Award from Indian Science Congress, Significant Contributions Award from CSI, Indira Gandhi Excellence Award from International Business Council, by Microsoft IT Academy and Reorganization of Commitment to Student Success through Excellence in IT Education, and many more. He has led and secured minor research project grants as a principal investigator from funding agencies like AICTE and GujCost. In context to collaborative research knowledge dissemination, he had initiated a peer-reviewed index journal, National Journal of System and Information Technology, in the year of 2008. He is the chief editor of this journal and even member of editorial board, as well as reviewer of several other research journals like International Journal of Information and Computing Technology. He has led the editorial committees for publishing proceedings for national conferences that include NCIRP 2006, IDBIT 2008, IS 2009, NCTDS 2011 on recent and relevant themes of computer, IT and knowledge management topics. He has organized 3 national conferences and several seminars and workshops successfully. He has been a member of several program committees of national and international conferences. He has also contributed in initiating and coordinating MCA, PGDCA, BCA, MSCCA, Integrated MSCIT, and Integrated MSC program, MCA program, and several add-on certificate courses at universities served by him. The MCA program at Srimka was the first of its kind to get accredited by NBA. To keep such courses up to date with industry demand and to have quality teaching learning environment, Dr. Patel has significantly contributed in defining the design and delivery of curricula as well as development of education strategies and operational standards. The renovation and revolution in form of outcome-based teaching and learning includes curriculum designing, is progress well under his guidance for computer science at the campus. Enough development and implementation took place for continuous evaluation and monitoring system covering majority points of overall technical and professional development of students as well as for faculty members. His far-sighted and visionary characteristics has also resulted to successful development of paperless university examination, student information system, automatic question generation systems, and other such systems that enable smooth governance of institute and university. With the purpose of resource enhancement, he has also been pioneer in designing fully Wi-Fi campus at a rural place, which is evident as Wi-Fi Maliba campus at UCA Tersaia University. Campus CCTV as well as data networks design and implementation at UTU cannot be let off easy when reusability of resources is the criteria for which a foresighted phase-based planning and implementation was carried out. The IBM Center of Excellence was started in 2009 at Srimka as the liaison of academia with industry under his leadership. Such institute-industry linkage has resulted to MOU and knowledge transfer with renowned organizations like IBM and TCS. He is a life member of several non-profit professional organizations like Computer Society of India, CSIR, Indian Science Congress, Bioinformatics Institute of India, etc. His extension activities as a founder, student, counselor of CSI student branch Bardoli is remarkable when he promoted several activities of Computer Society of India at national and state level events. We are fortunate to have you, sir. Sir is going to deliver a talk on outcome-based education. So I welcome you once again, sir. Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kumar. Dear all, good evening. I am very much thankful in advance for sparing your valuable time, not only for improving my knowledge, but hopefully you will also get an opportunity to resolve your some of the queries which as a good teacher you may have in your mind. Of course, teaching and learning is a one of the major activity as far as teacher is concerned. But the thing is, it is not just a communication platform where I have to express myself and other has to listen it. From the beginning, we are very much aware that there are so many changes took place in other places, in other areas, and the same is applicable even in a teaching professional too. When I am talking with respect to those changes, naturally you have a solutions also for those changes when you are facing some of the problems, and those solutions naturally, you may have tried to implement also. It may possible that you may not get an opportunity or a platform to implement such solutions. So this is in a way, it is an, I can say that a one of the direction that is usually there. But how you speedily and how effectively as well as efficiently you will work on it is of a major concern. So this is the time normally where we are becoming more attentive. I do not mean to say that earlier we were not more attentive, but now in a professional world, it becomes feel that it becomes a buzzword to become more attentive towards the teaching and learning with respect to the outcome-based learning. I don't think that outcome learning is a new paradigm or a one kind of a things that is highly associated with this environment or this time only, but it is since long existing and we usually directly indirectly following it. So this is the way you may feel it. You may feel it that why not we should begin with our topic. But in a way, actually I have started since long with respect to this topic. How I can say that I have already started? Yeah, now it is audible to everybody.
Yeah, sir. I think now it is clear.
So the point is, usually when we begin our session, either way we are taking some time to adjust the learning. And this is what I have tried to do with you. The thing is, it is one of my objectives. Not new, exactly. We can say that we are not in a position to file a patent for such objective because it is well-known phenomena. When you are in a one environment, moving in another environment, you need an adjustment time. So previously you have a one session of a patent. Now you have another session. In between, some adjustment time is required. So that you become more attentive, you will be able to adjust yourself. And this is what I have given a time. However, when I am talking with respect to this adjustment time, you may feel it how I have evaluated, how I took a measurement of it. Naturally, I do not have any measurement tool, but I assume that you have adjusted yourselves. So this is the reason why now I am moving towards further in this particular topic. I am not putting a title of my topic because it has been repeated many times. And repeating the things frequently, it may not be of that much usefulness. So by these particular things, not repeating my title, I have tried to focus on two things. One is when you start delivering, from a learner also you are expecting something as far as readiness is concerned. And this is what I am expecting from you, that you are at least aware with respect to what you are going to learn or listen from onwards. And this is the one of the reason, one of the objective why I am not sharing my title with you. Second thing is, I am assuming that you have that ability, you have that understanding that what I am going to cover by one or another means, because you have followed a process of a registration, you have followed a process of, you have seen the announcement and so on. So this is the way you have required knowledge that has been acquired by you in this particular session. And this is the reason why I am not sharing my talk. Again, how much of you are knowing with respect to the exact title, that is again one of the measurement criteria But again, I do not have any tool which can measure it online just now and let me know that how many of you are aware. So this is the limitation, or you can say the constraint that we are facing as on today as far as objective measurement is concerned. And since we have a such deficiency with respect to measuring our objective, we are sometimes unable to find the exact result, whether I have achieved or not in this context. So going further, I am sure that you have adjusted yourself. You have motivated yourselves also, because I have said that you have a solution for your problems in the context of routine activities. So my focus onwards will be on a two major point. One is, I can say that UGC has recently announced one thing, that now onwards students may be allowed to go with a 2-degree program simultaneously. One is in a regular mode, another is maybe in a distance mode, or the way it is feasible. This is one of the major things that where our attention must be there as a teacher. How I will link it with respect to the outcome-based learning, that you have to observe very closely during these sessions. I am not exclusively going to focus on this point, that what you should do and what you should not do. But sometime I may use my presentation that will guide you more with respect to the points that you have to prepare yourselves. So this is one point, that is the announcement of a UGC. Second one is, I would like to focus on one of the advertisement. That advertisement is related to something like the statement, Chaudhary Sahib ka lecture shuru hone wala hai, something like that. Now when I have focused on these two points, at this moment, you may have several other points in your mind. When I say advertisement, you may have came across, or you may be thinking of some of the advertisement that most recently you must have gone through. So the thing is, when you have some idea with respect to some of the points, and when others are giving you a new direction, with respect to that point, there at that juncture, you need to be more attentive, because that is a specific objective based point has been kept in front of you. So now, in addition to these two points, I have other two points also, which I will share throughout this session, indirectly with respect to these two points. So these two, another additional point that I am sharing on a PPT, of course, my intention for sharing this PPT is a different, that I will let you know at the later in the session. Now I am sharing my PPT. It's easy for you to go through this slide. I wish that you are reading this slide carefully. Now the thing is, why I have keep some interval of a blank time, because we as a teacher, we all are very much aware that one thing, you may not be as a student, students may not be able to continuously attentive towards what you are saying. And hence, a students require a slight time to diversify his mind of a concentration. Meaning is, where to use which tool is of a more importance than what to speak out in front of them. Of course, what to speak out, that is equally important, but uses of tool we can't neglect. I have put up additional attention on this particular slide because as a teacher, we have some role models in our mind. Knowingly, unknowingly, we are following the philosophy of that role model. Naturally, I need not to say that one of the role model is to whom I love. It is in front of you. So, the statement that he has quoted, why I am putting here, because that is the statement that he has written to as a reply to one of the educationalists. Going further, additional point will be, UNESCO has defined the learning process, and that is what in front of you. Please go through each word carefully. If you wish, you may note down them also. I hope you must have completed the task of noting down it. Moving further, you will find nothing on your screen, because now onwards your attention towards what I speak out is of more importance than seeing the screen of your laptop or of your devices. When we are talking about this additional 2 point, one is related to Tata sir, and another is with respect to the UNESCO. You try to see, there are so many similarities. We are very much aware with respect to the synonyms of word, but here I am talking with respect to not synonyms of word, but the similarity of a words. And that is what is expected to understand it as a teacher. I mean to say that just go on speaking for hours, it is of no uses. When you are teaching to a student, we need to be very precise with respect to what we are going to convey them. First thing, that is, what is our technical objective of a topic to be taught to them. Second one is equally important, is how I am going to deliver it. Third important thing is, whatever I have delivered, is students have understood it? Are they able to apply them in a problem solving approach? Are they having a ability not only to apply their knowledge, but its usability with respect to the helping others and so on has been developed or not? That is of a major concern. And these things have been highlighted in these two additional points. Now coming back to that UGC announcement and Chaudhary sir ka lecture shuru hone wala hai. With respect to these 2 points, parallelly on other additional points, would like to focus that nowadays a teacher having so many challenges. I do not mean to say these challenges were new, but of course, because of a recent development, always it add more additional challenges to individuals. And looking to that, I can say that earlier, institute were known because of its historical development, because of a long time development of the institute with respect to their fixed mission and vision statement. Now days are coming where, like an institute, teacher will be known by its performance. And that is the reason why Chaudhary sir ka lecture hai, chalo chalna hai, that type of feelings we have to create in the mind of a learner. It is only possible when you focus on some additional parameters that not only limited to a slow learner but to an advanced learner also. My meaning of intention is that when you are delivering a topic, just now it should not be limited to one class of a learner. That means I have a lecture, I have delivered it without grouping my students, that is a heterogeneous group. Some of the students may be able to learn very speedily. Some of the students may not be able to learn speedily. They are known as a slow learner. How I am bridging this gap between these two learners, that is of a major concern for a teacher. You can't say that, okay, they will learn themselves, or at the same time, you can't say that, okay, advanced learner will do themselves when I will provide them additional material. You have to work simultaneously in the way that how you can make a busy advanced learner also, at the same time focusing on average as well as slow learner. That means you are teaching one topic, although your attention is divided into three parts. One is associated with the slow learner, another is with respect to average learner, and third one is with respect to the advanced learner. The thing is, when you are thinking like that way, you need to think of evaluation and assessment as an integral part of your teaching and learning process. Currently, it so happens in majority cases, I do not mean to say that in all cases, but while we are teaching them, we are playing a one-directional role. We are delivering them, but we are not making sure that that delivery has reached to a concern in what percentage. I have taken a 1 hour lectures. I may not be aware, or I may not be able to answer very precisely that how much they have gained. It is because of lack of evaluation as well as assessment as an integral part of my teaching learning. So when you are preparing your lesson, of course, as a teacher, since you did a post graduation in your subject, further you have carried out a PhD also, you earn a PhD degree also, you have enough mastery as far as your subject matter is concerned. Even it is not expected that whatever you are knowing, everything to be delivered to a students. But the thing is, whatever I am delivering, is my students are getting satisfied? If it is not so, then they may not say that chalo Chaudhary sahab ka lecture hai, humko attend karna. We have to satisfy our student in this context. And for that, lesson preparation is going to be extremely important factor or parameter as far as coming days is concerned. As I have said, that you have enough technical or subject related knowledge. So what is required is your planning with respect to the delivery, because there we may be extremely poor, we may not have much formal knowledge or education in the context of a delivering of a methodology, and hence it is expected that when I am preparing, I need to be very precise that what I am going to cover, up to what depth is a major concern, because on one side you have a syllabus, on another side you have a students, in which you have a mixed mode of a student's nature. As I have said, you have a slow learner, average learner, as well as advanced learner. Advanced learner is expecting more than what you have in your syllabus. So while preparing your session, what else and in what format should be given so that advanced learner gets satisfied? Keep in mind, advanced learner is just like a gold of any institute. The things, the achievement that advanced learner are going to achieve in the coming years, when they becomes the member of alumni of the institute, they are going to improve the quality or increase the societal impact of the institute, not only of an institute but teacher also. We came across so many examples where such students, such alumni, they say proudly in front of publicly that this is my teacher, what has been taught to me, and because of that only I am doing something, likewise and so on. So the point is, when you are preparing, again I am repeating the things, that subject technical depth, that is a topic that you are going to deliver, you have a reasonably good knowledge. Your attention should be on a delivery mechanism. Your attention should be on a which tool I will use to present my delivery in a best of manner. What I should do, which measurement tool I should use, so that I am able to get an idea that whether students have received what I want to convey and so on. Now the thing is, if you feel it, you may feel it, that if I make an evaluation and assessment as an integral part of my lecture, then how I will manage myself? The answer is, as on today, you have so many tools ready-made available, where even it is possible for you to prepare a small quiz of a 5 minutes, and you can take it online, maybe with respect to the smartphones available with the students or by other means. It is not necessary that such evaluation must be taken during the class only, but it can be even otherwise also taken, keeping from a day interval to a 1 week interval or 1 month interval. You may assign some problems and introduce the complexity of such problems gradually, so that at the end of this month or so, a student may have a different solution for that problem, and they will be able to determine that under which circumstances which solution will be. So meaning is, usually we ignore the delivery mechanism. Looking to the recent development, we need to be more attentive, because say for example, your university is going to offer a certificate program where students can enroll offline, that means not in a regular mode, it may be in a distance mode. And when we say distance mode, you may have to deliver your talk either online or by other means. Since they have enrolled in a regular program, it is very difficult for them also to spare a time during the morning 10 to 5. At the same time, it may not be possible for you to spare a time after 8 to 5, in between 8 to 5, because you are at institute. Available time is maybe after 5, and that time to be utilized in a best of manner, that means you may not be able to interact directly daily on a daily basis with them. What you will do? You have to find an alternative solution. And that is what is going on as on today. You can prepare your videos and you can share with your students. These videos, however, will not take a place of a teacher. Will not take a place of a teacher in two contexts. That UNESCO said in the beginning, in the beginning of the slide, I have said that UNESCO will focus on an emotional parameter too. That means when we are talking with respect to learning mechanism, how emotionally you are attached with your students, that is also equally important. In my videos, what I should do so that I remain emotionally attached with them, indirectly forcing them to instruct them that whenever they have some difficulty, they can share with you freely without any kind of hesitation. And that emotional attachment will remains all the time. That means it make a life with a student and teacher relation. And this is the one of the reason why as on today, so many videos were available, but not customized video. By this customized video, what I mean to say, that at this moment, suppose for a topic you have prepared one video, you should not feel that that will be used frequently whenever you are delivering that topic. You must have experienced many times that when we are attending some sessions, you will see the same PPT slide which has been used by the expert. That means it is not a customized. It has been prepared once, used many times. We need to come out from it. We need to prepare our videos or material once. It must be used once only. We need to have a refinement process where based on my experience, based on my measurement tool, I need to identify what are the deficiencies that I need to address subsequently. I am putting another situation also, that over a period of time, a technical or a term that requires more attention in the beginning, but over a period of time, it becomes so popular that its attention may not be that much required. That means when you are delivering a one topic, like say for example operating system, it was previously limited to a group of persons who are associated with computer science. But nowadays it is not so because of a smartphone. Even those who are not associated with computer science, when they are purchasing or buying a smartphone, they ask about the operating system. Android is one of the popular names. Or hence, even a non-technical person also able to say the name of an operating system. So before, suppose say for example 10 years or before 5 years, if I used to take a half an hour for introducing the definition of an operating system, it is not required at all as on today. I may have to restrict myself with respect to maybe 10 minutes because of the requirement from the technical perspective's point of view. And these requirements of a 10 minutes, I need to be a major concern. Because in a syllabus, it may be a definition itself. But previously, it was of a half an hour allocation. Now I have a 10 minutes allocation only. So what else I should do? Assuming that the same syllabus as on today also. So what I should do for that 20 minutes? If I am going to take that 30 minutes itself, students, particularly advanced learner, are not going to get enjoyment. What I should do? In additional 20 minutes, how I should focus on advanced learner? And at the same time, keeping busy my slow learner as well as average learner, that is of a major concern. And that is the reason why I say that once you have prepared, don't assume that it is going to be used forever. Every time when you are delivering that the same subject, because it so happened that a one subject we used to teach for a 4 years, 5 years, sometimes even more also. What additionally you are going to provide them is of a major concern. And accordingly, it is expected that you should prepare your content. So your objective of a delivery, to whom you are going to deliver, that is of a major concern. Say, again, I am talking with respect to the UGC announcement, because when a student says enrolled as a part-time student, the intention of that part-time students and the intention of a regular students may vary. I do not mean to say that part-time students require only the part-time degree. Because when a student is going for a 2 degrees parallelly, one is a regular, another is as a part-time, naturally his intention is towards the gaining more and more knowledge. That means he is expecting much more, even sometime, compared to regular students. And this is what we need to be very attentive. Now going further, that this is with respect to the delivery of a content. But when we are talking of a outcome learning, outcome based learning, apart from delivery mechanism, measurement or evaluation, that is going to a equally, that is going to play equally important role. Because onwards, we may not be able to rely on a mechanism of taking two internal exam, one in the mid or another at the end, but our attention must be towards the continuous evaluation of our students. Continuous evaluation is expected in the sense that by that way only we able to measure their academic performance only. Continuous evaluation may not be give us an idea other than their academic measurement. Meaning is that how much satisfaction a learner is getting from my delivery mechanism is the another aspect, another parameters to be taken into account. Academic performance is a one aspect, but the popularity of a teacher, like that of an institute, is also going to be a equal of importance in the forthcoming year. And that depends on a teacher. That depends on your measurement tool, which assists you to determine at what level you have satisfied your students. And up to what level you are able to progress them, not only with respect to the academic, but as per the societal need also. I agree that academic evaluation, academic measurement, almost all we are doing. But in majority cases, we are less focused with respect to their satisfaction level of a delivery, with respect to what they want to know and so on. For that, as a teacher, we need to think in a different way, and there it so happened that you have an opportunity to design your own measurement tool. Own measurement tool in the sense that for each session or a couple of sessions, you have some objective. For each topic, you have some objective. For each unit of a syllabus, you have some objectives. For whole subject, you have some objectives. And the subject as a part of the degree, you have some other objectives. Where and what way you have measured it, for that you may not find a one ready-made single tool which focus on it. Your objective of teaching a topic may not be similar to the objective of teaching the same subject topic by me. Because your intention may be sometime is whether they have understood or not. My intention may be a slightly different compared to that. And this is the reason That's why academic performance can be measured by a single one question paper to all students, irrespective that subject is taught by how many teachers. You must have an experience also that in a one university there are 25 colleges running the program. That means 25 different teachers are teaching that subject. And question paper will be set by one or two or three of such teachers. Although that question paper is applicable to all the students of a 25 colleges, because it is an academic measurement based on the syllabus. As far as my focus of a point is that it's okay, academic performance we have to, I do not mean to say that academic performance should not be measured. But how we can measure ourselves as a teacher in front of a students, that is also going to play a key role. That means effectiveness and efficiency of teacher to be measured by a student, that is also going to be of equal importance in the coming future. Then and then only, a students will say that, chalo, we have a lecture of this teacher and we need to attend it. They should keen determine to put their ongoing activity aside and tempted to attend your session. That type of environment we have to create. And in that environment, as I have said, evaluation and assessment is going to play a crucial role. Unless and until we will not take it as an integral part, I don't think we will be able to achieve a good result. Good result does not mean with respect to teaching them academically, but how we are training them for a lifelong learner. You have faced so many problems under a different situations, and you may have resolved them also, because your attention is not limited to teaching them academically. As a teacher, our attention is always to remain with our students, emotionally also, socially as well. Our intention to give them knowledge as much as possible, we need to create creativity in their mind and so on. If these are our intentions, then naturally this lesson preparation, not only with respect to the topic what I need to deliver, but as I have discussed other parameters, we need to be very precise. We have a usual experience that this batch is not up to mark with respect to previous batch. Sometimes it so happens that you have a mixed mode of a students. In such situations, it is expected that you need to be very precise as far as lesson preparation is concerned, which I feel that as on today, most ignored component. I hope that you will take a reasonably good parameters before preparing your session. Reasonably good parameter, that means to whom I have to deliver. what knowledge they have, what level of students, that means what percentage of a students belongs to an average learner, slow learner, advanced learner. There may not be well-defined definition of this category of a students. It all depends on you. It all depends on your experience. It all depends how you are dealing with your students. And this is the reason how I can say that while preparing your lesson, your perception as well as your understanding of a student's going to play a major role. Like content delivery, the perception of your process going to play a major ongoing activity in the preparation of a lesson. And that is the reason sometimes I feel that I have resolved one problem, prepared well for a next session, I may going to face another problem. That means moving from deterministic to non-deterministic model. And again, sometimes it so happened that moving again in a deterministic. This is the continuous ongoing activity that we have to follow it. That means I can say slightly in a different way that it is not so that once I have resolved a one problem, that may be academic problem, that may be a my process problem, that may be a psychological problem of a students. I am not going to face them again and again, it is not so. I am going to face these problems again and again, and it is not necessary that the same solution will be applicable at the later. Meaning is, it is in front of your screen. I hope that you agree with this. For making this agreeness, I can say that teachers love learning. That means, as I have pointed out earlier, you have a reasonably good command on your subject knowledge, but evaluation assessment on a continuous basis, we need to create more and more tools like rubrics, which may be of a different nature from time to time. You need to think them major academically also, not with the same typical questions that we used to ask, but putting their academic problems in a different way. We will be able to measure them academically also in a better way. So this is what I have to say in front of you with respect to the outcome-based learning. In all, if I have to summarize, I can say that in the coming days, our attention must not be limited to delivering them or making them academically good, but we have to think seriously how and what we should do so that that overall development is of a quality in nature. And there, of course, you can again refer back to the statements, additional attention points, number one of a GRD Tata. That is, no success or achievement in the material term is worthwhile unless it solves the need of the interest of the country and its people and is achieved by fair and honest means. And is achieved by fair and honest means, it is our responsibility. And for that, continuous efforts are required. Continuously, we have to update ourselves so that the four pillar of a UNESCO learning, we can satisfy it in a best of manner. That means whenever we are preparing our session, whenever we are preparing our lecture, out of this, know, do, be, and live together. My attention is on what? On which skill set? Intellectual, creativity, emotional, social, physical, or spiritual development is focused on. It is not so that when we are teaching them technical subjects, physical and spiritual as well as social skill set cannot be focused. Of course, I may not be able to give you several examples in this context, but a good teacher will always find some exercise where attention may be given. At the same time, your perception must be towards the happiness, prosperity, and materialistic goals as well as ethical human behavior for its students. So this is what I have to say in short. Of course, with respect to outcome-based learning, so many things, so many lectures you must have attended. I have tried to put up the things slightly in a different way. And what should be done so that you can become more effective as far as our teaching and learning mechanism is concerned. So finally,
okay, so thanks a lot, sir, for sharing your valuable insights about the four aspects, which is very, very important for a teacher. You have rightly pointed that there are many challenges in front of a teachers, and the teacher's role is now changing and not restricted only to an instructor, but also leading to a trainer, facilitator, and mentor to target the outcome-based education. So that's a wonderful session, sir. There are a few questions we would take up. The first question was on how one can identify the slow and advanced learner so that we can target appropriate strategies to them.
As I have said, there is no clear definition as far as slow learner, advanced, and average learner is concerned. As I have also pointed out, that it so happened that when you are comparing your current bench with a past batch, you may be able to conclude that this batch is not up to level, or you may be able to say that this is the super batch. And depending on that characteristics also, the definition of a slow learner, advanced learner, and average learner will vary. The thing is, usually, based on their academic performance, we able to identify them, or we able to categorize them in a slow average and advanced learning. Of course, again, the criteria may be different. I may say that a percentage of a 50% all belongs to a slow learner, between 50 to 70 average and 72 onwards, they are advanced learner. Some teacher may not be agree with this parameter, may have their own parameter depending on the importance of their subjects, depending on the contribution of the subjects that going to play a role as far as students' career development is concerned. Because in a current system, you may find a subject which is of an allied nature and which may not be going to play crucial role for all skill sets. In that circumstances, a teacher has a freedom to whom he or she would like to consider as an average or advanced learner. So there is no clear guidelines. It depends on a teacher only. But at large, we can say that based on their academic performance, looking to the importance of my subject that I am going to teach them, we can classify students in some level that is a slow learner, average, as well as advanced learner.
Right. Sir, there is another question in line with this. How we can bring the slow learners to an advanced learners, and the similar to it, I mean, can we focus on slow learners in distance education more?
So basically, as I have said, that we are classifying them based on their performance, that is the academic performance. There we have never focused on other parameter like their learning attitude and so on. Sometimes it so happened that because of one or another reason, they are not motivated towards the learning process. And hence, since they are not motivated, say for example, they have been forced to take admission in X program, whereas he or she students may be interested in a Y program. We must have an experience of such students. Now the thing is, if we find that a student has taken an admission in X program, he do not have any choice because parent may have forced him. As a teacher, we have to motivate them in such a way that they are able to understand the importance of that particular degree program. We have to create an impression in that mind that their parents' decision is also not wrong decision. I do not mean to say that correct one. Like say for example, a one student may be interested to build up his career in the cricket. And suppose he has taken an admission in a professional program like engineering program. Naturally, obviously, those both objective gets conflict. And in that circumstances, we have to convince them that why you may not be able to develop your career as a cricketer. We have to motivate him that how you can continue his or her program in a study precisely. So this all are depends on a situation as well as individuals. And this is the reason why I have said that there is no solution, there is no steps. That if you follow these five steps, the advanced learner, slow learner becomes the advanced learner. We need to observe them. And this is the reason why I have said that academically measurement is not only going to play a crucial role. Apart from academic measurement, we need to focus on other measurement criteria also. And that is going to be play a crucial role. For that, we need to have some rubrics in our hand.
Right. So Thank you very much, sir, for your insightful session. I can see tons of comments, very good comments about your session. So thank you very much once again on behalf of IQAC cell of Bukat Asahi University. I am really very thankful for your insightful session. Thanks, thanks again. Thank you. Participants, we again going to meet tomorrow, sharp at 3:25. Again, request to all participants to fill up the attendance, feedback form and quiz before 12 noon tomorrow. So see you again at 3:25 tomorrow for another 3 sessions. Thank you very much. Stay safe, stay home. Thank you.